34, check 1, 2.
We ready? We're gonna sing Jesus song. You know, I've noticed every See, we didn't know whether to try to do a message in music, but now we're gonna pull something on you in a couple of weeks. It's from the same band that did the sunglasses song. Same band, but I bet you've never heard this one. But it's a good rocker, kind of bluesy rock. We're gonna unleash it on the world Wednesday.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. If you'll go ahead and take your seats, we'll get ready to get started. We're proud you're with us on Wednesday night. We're probably going to have some other people coming in. I think some of the students are going to come be with us. And you're all wondering, what are we doing tonight? Well, we're going to share something new with you. Ray's going to introduce that to you. All I can do is tell you it is 41. Can y'all remember that number? 41. Think of that, but we're going to do something. We've been thinking about creative ways that we could bring our church together and get people on the same page, because we've been kind of disconnected over the past year. And so this is one of the things we're going to try. We think it'll be a blessing to you. And I won't say any more about that. Ray can introduce that to you in just a minute. But we appreciate you being here. At the end of our service, we're going to have a prayer time. And for all of you online, we appreciate you tuning in with us as well. We're going to have our prayer time. There's a prayer list in the back. If you have somebody that you want us to pray for, if you please put their name there, we'll go make some copies of that. We usually spread those out across the altar, and then you can pick one up after you leave tonight if you need it, or you can get one when we have our prayer time. And so we encourage you to do that. Hope you've had a good week. We've had a couple of funerals, one Monday and one yesterday. And so I want you to pray for a couple of families tonight. That'll be the Rentoul family, for Nash Rentoul's family, and also for Bobby, let's see, what's his name? Joey Lee. Joey Lee was his name. Miss Marcia, that used to be one of our members, her husband passed away. We did his memorial service on Monday. And so a lot of people probably in need of prayer and encouragement. I may be one of them. You may be one of them. We'll see if we can encourage one another tonight. Let's bow together, go before the Lord in prayer, and then we will get started this evening. God, we love you so much, and just thank you for life. Thank you for this past week, God, not only for our students coming together and having a spiritually time of bonding and loving one another, encourage one another, growing together in the Lord. And so we celebrate all these young people, God, and may you increase our tribe with young people. And Lord, help us to be sensitive when we see people everywhere we go, that we should invite everyone to come and worship with us. And if the opportunity arises, we should share with everyone our love for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I pray, God, that as the world opens back up in 2021, as it's already started, I pray we'll have that opportunity to interact and to build and sow seeds for relationships, especially those who need you as personal Lord and Savior. So thank you. Thank you for our blessings. Thank you for the privilege of coming together tonight. Lead us in this time. Thank you for Brother Mark and Brother Neil leading us in our worship time. And we pray, Lord, tonight that we will know we're in your presence and you have a plan and a purpose for our life. And so thank you for everything. All glory and praise and honor be given unto you. We love you. We adore you. And we lift your name on high. Bless us as we meet together this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sure is good to see you this evening. I think we've got a bigger crowd in here than usual, which is wonderful. I guess more people getting the COVID vaccinations, maybe? Coming out maybe a little bit more? No? Maybe? I don't know. I got my first one.
Anybody?
my arm nearly fell off. Just kidding out there. It was okay. I'm going to get the second one. Anyhow, it's good to be here. Let's sing I Saw the Light. We hadn't done that one in a while. Let's lift our voices. Can we do that?
Ready, Mark? Here he's good.
I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin, and I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. But then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. That looked good. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Well, just like a blind man, I wandered alone. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. And then like the blind man that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. And I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. And now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I was a fool to wander and stray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Amen. Right. Hey, we're going to have to do that every week if y'all participate like that. That was wonderful. Praise the Lord. That's great. This is not I Saw the Light, but this is another one that's kind of got a little rhythm to it here. If I can get this capo on tight enough. Close enough, okay? Stand in your love. Let's see if we can sing this. When darkness tries to roll over my bones, sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Well, shame no longer has a place to hide, and I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't
doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And there's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out the grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. I stand in your love.
Well, good evening. I hope you have a handout. I want to take you through something that God's been putting on my heart for the last couple of weeks, and it's simply entitled 41. 41, and I want to take you on a journey to get there so you can see where I've been and hopefully where God's going to take us. And I'm glad our youth are with us tonight because you just came off this Make It Matter weekend. And so I was trying to find a way to bring the whole church together. And we used to do a 40-day journey in the church I came from. We would take the whole church together for 40 days. And we would go through a study, purpose-driven life is 40 days. Rick Warren, Draw the Circle is a 40-day journey that some people in our church have done. The AHA is a Kyle Ottoman study on the prodigal son. It's a 40-day journey. And so I put all these things together, and I took it to my beautiful bride and my wise wife. And I said, what do you think? We're going to do a 40-day journey. And she said, what are you going to do with all these things you've got? You're just going to let the church pick? And I said, well, what do you think? And she said, no, I think we all do the same thing. And so I started thinking about how we could all do the same thing and which one we need to do. And she said, why don't you write something? And I said, how come every time you have an idea, it requires more work for me, right? And so I decided I'd pray about it. And so I started writing a 40-day devotional. And I'm 24 days in. I got 16 more days to write. And so I want to share with you how that came about. I was in Luke chapter 5. And if you have God's word, go to Luke chapter 5. I want to show you where it all started. And I want you to think about this. You know, God has a desire to deliver you. God wants to heal you. He wants to restore you. He wants to redeem you. He really wants to set you free. We're all wondering about a pandemic, wondering about when everybody's going to get back to church. But there's a greater plan that God has for us. He is a God who moves. He's a God who works. And the same God who did miracles in the Old Testament is the same God who can do those miracles in our New Testament time. And so you have to ask the question, do we not have enough faith in the same God that they had faith in the Old Testament when you read about all the miracles that took place? And so God desires to heal, and it's made plain in this story about this leper, and I want you to see it. Luke chapter 5, verse 12. While Jesus was in one of the towns, a man came along who was covered with leprosy. And when he saw Jesus, he fell with his face to the ground and begged him, and listen to what he said. He said, Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean. If you're willing. Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. Now, it's amazing to me that Jesus touched him. You know, if this was brought into our today's imagination, Jesus would be speaking to someone with COVID-19 with no mask on. He'd be hugging him during the greeting time. He'd be reaching out and touching him. And this is a man who's got leprosy, and Jesus doesn't hide behind, I got to make sure I don't get it. Jesus touches him. But then listen to what he says. He says, I am willing. Remember the man said, Lord, if you're willing? And Jesus said, I am. And I want to share with you tonight that the Jesus that was willing then is the same Jesus that's willing now. He wants to come and he wants to heal us. He wants to put his arms around our situation. He wants to restore us and he wants to redeem us. And he said, be clean. And immediately the leprosy left him. Then Jesus ordered him, don't tell anyone, but go show yourself to the priests and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them. Don't say anything to anybody else, but go be a testimony to the religious leaders. Let these religious leaders who have a religion know that there is a God who heals. And yet the news about him spread all the more. You know, every time Jesus told people to be quiet, the news just spread about him more and more and more. So the crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sicknesses. I love that Jesus touches the untouchable. I love that Jesus said, I'm willing. I don't know what your giant is. I don't know what you're struggling with. But if you went to the Lord tonight and whatever you're struggling with and you said, Lord, if you're willing, I'll go ahead and give the answer. He is. He's willing. He wants to help you to be clean from whatever you're dealing with, whatever you're facing. And so the good news is that Jesus wants to heal you. He wants to deliver you. He wants to empower you. And then I read Galatians 5:1. Galatians 5:1 says this, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. It's for freedom. Now, if you and I, students of the Bible, were to read this, you would think that there would be another word that goes in place of the word freedom. It's for forgiveness that Christ has set us free. But God laid this statement on my heart, and I was going to save it for Real Life University. And he said, kind of in my spirit, what are you saving it for? Because we're all in real life. We need it right now. And here's the statement. He didn't come just to forgive you. He came to free you. He didn't just come to forgive us. He came to set us free from some things. He didn't just come so that we can make it to heaven one day, but so we can have real life on earth right now. He came to set us free. And so I started looking through scripture, and so how did God set people free when they were in their trials, when they're in their tribulations, when they were in their distress, when they were in their times of hurting, like we've been in this time right now in our country for the last year. And every time I found a place where people were going through a trial, going through a hurt, it revolved around 40 days. 40 days. In fact, the phrase 40 days shows up 146 times in scripture. And I want to give you just a couple of those tonight. And you're saying, well, Brother Ray, it's entitled 41. It's not entitled 40, and there's a reason behind it. So just hold on. But 40 symbolizes the consequences of bad decisions. I'm just going to give you the times that are 40 days. I could give you the times, and Scripture talks about 40 years. The nation of Israel, they wandered for 40 more years in the wilderness because Numbers 13 says they listened to the majority, and the majority was wrong. Moses, he spends 40 years under Pharaoh, and then he spends 40 years out wandering in the wilderness before God shows up to him in a burning bush and says, take off your sandals for the place you're standing on is holy ground. And then 40 years after that would be a time that God would use Moses in a powerful way to lead the people out of Egypt. But they were based on these 40-year sections. 40 was always a time of trials. It was always a time of testing in Scripture. And in fact, look at the examples I gave you in your handout. Genesis 7, verse 12, Noah says, and rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Now, why 40 days and why 40 nights? Because on day 41, the rain's going to stop. Scripture is so specific and detailed to tell us that it didn't just rain 40 days and stop in the middle of the 40th day. It said it rained 40 days and 40 nights. And verse 17 of Genesis 7 says, for 40 days the flood kept coming on the earth. And as the waters increased, they lifted the ark high above the earth. 40 days of floods. 40 days of God's judgment. 40 days of people perishing. And then Genesis 8, verse 6 says this, after 40 days, Noah opened the window he had made in the ark. Aren't you glad God told Noah to put a window in it? He put a window in it because there was hope coming. And he sent out a raven, and it kept flying back and forth until the water had dried up from the earth. Remember, 40 days of flooding, but day 41, the rain stops. 41 is going to be a day of deliverance. Exodus 24, verse Verse 18, then Moses entered the cloud as he went up on the mountain. He's on Mount Sinai. He's in the Shekinah glory cloud of God. And he stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. He's going to get the first set of tablets, the first set of the Ten Commandments. But he's going to have to get a second tablet because of disobedience. And in Exodus 34, verse 28, you would think the second time he got the Ten Commandments, it wouldn't take as long as the first time, right? Because they'd already written them once. But Exodus 34, 28, Moses was there with the Lord. Second time, 40 days and 40 nights, without eating bread or drinking water. And he wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. I mean, why 40 days and why 40 nights to get the law that none of us could keep? Maybe to reveal to us that the times of testing, day 41, God comes to save. In fact, while they were down there, Deuteronomy, I'm going to skip one, so skip this next one, we'll come back to Numbers. But the golden calf takes place between the two. And when Moses comes down and finds that they have made this golden calf, he's going to get on his face and he's going to pray that God doesn't judge those people for their sin. And guess how long he prays on his face? Deuteronomy 9, 25, he said, I lay prostrate before the Lord those 40 days and 40 nights because the Lord has said he would destroy you. I prayed to the Lord and said, O sovereign Lord, do not destroy your people, your own inheritance that you redeemed by your great power and brought out of Egypt with a mighty hand. 40 days and 40 nights. And on day 41, God spared them because Moses prayed. Then in Numbers, I told you about Numbers 13. The spies sent in to see the land, the promised land they were supposed to inherit. And said at the end of 40 days, verse 25 of Numbers 13, they returned from exploring the land. Keep showing up over and over again in Scripture. 40 days, 40 days, 40 days. Elijah is going to be strengthened by God. He's going to make a 40-day journey to the mountain of God, Horeb. 1 Kings 19, verse 8. So he got up and ate and drank. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. It took him 40 days to get to the place where God was going to show up in his life. He had to travel without eating or drinking. He was strengthened by God for that 40-day trial, that 40-day test. But then on day 41, he's in the presence of God in a powerful way. And Jonah ran from God, and then he's called back to the place he was supposed to start to go, and it's the city of Nineveh. It says this, in Jonah chapter 3, verse 4, on the first day Jonah started into the city, he proclaimed, 40 more days, and Nineveh will be overturned. 40 days, Nineveh, you got 40 days to repent. You got 40 days to think about your sin. You got 40 days, God says he's going to come and destroy you. And guess what? They repent, and on day 41, God relents. And then it shows up in the New Testament, because I know what some people think. No matter what church I preach in, whether it be a Baptist church, a non-denominational church, well, that's the Old Testament. Can you show us something in the New Testament, right? Well, I'll give you Matthew 4, verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit to the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, and this is kind of funny, he was hungry. I like they put that in there like we didn't know he was hungry after 40 days and 40 nights. Like after one day, I'm hungry. After 40 days and 40 nights, he's hungry. Why would Jesus be tested for a specific amount of time? Why that period of time? Why 40 days and 40 nights? Because on day 41, the angels are going to come and attend to him. On day 41, deliverance takes place for the Son of God. And then Acts chapter 1, verse 3. After his suffering, he, Jesus, showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He gives these post-resurrection appearances for 40 days. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. For 40 days, he's telling them, hey, look at my hands. Look at my side. And guess what happens on day 41? He ascends in victory. 40 days of trying to teach these disciples. 40 days of trying to inspire them for the test that's going to come. And then he goes on day 41 to heaven over and over again. 40 days, 40 days is trials, 40 days is testing. But day 41, deliverance takes place. And I thought, what if we could bring the people around 40 days? What if we could get everybody together in God's word for 40 days? What would that look like if we studied the same text and I would write something to help people understand some of it, and we got together around 40 days, and on day 41, people can be set free from some things they're going through. What if God wanted to just take us through these 40 days? Maybe day 41 for you, you could be delivered from something going on in your marriage, or maybe day 41, you could be delivered from an addiction that's going on in your life. Maybe day 41, you can get rid of pornography, or maybe day 41, you can put alcohol down for good. Maybe on day 41, God could set you free. And I thought, what needs to be day 41? Easter. And so I'm a math minor, so I got my calendar out, and I backed up 41 days from April 4th, and it's February the 23rd. So we're going to start 41 days on February 23rd. Day one will be on a Tuesday, February 23rd. Well, what are we going to do? How are we going to study God's Word? Because we're not using a book somebody else wrote. And as I was talking to my wife, the Lord just impressed on me, use my Word. Don't use what somebody else wrote. Use my Word. And so I pulled up chapters and how many chapters are in different books. And I thought, you know, there's only one book of the Bible that's 40 days and it's 40 chapters. It's Exodus. That would be one chapter a day. And I said, but maybe God wants to put the Old Testament and New Testament together. And so I found all these combinations. I found that you could read Daniel, the book of Daniel is 12 chapters, and you could take the book of Romans, which is 28, and I did the math behind that, 40 days, and then day 41 we celebrate. But I didn't have a good piece about Daniel, the book of Romans. Daniel, the book of Acts, we could have done the same thing. And then I said, Joshua. Joshua is 24 chapters, and the Gospel of Mark is 14. We could take the nation of Israel getting to their promised land after wandering around for 40 years. We could get to their year 41 and study them getting to promised land living. And then we can take the Gospel of Mark, which is about Jesus, the suffering servant, the most detailed, succinct. In fact, the word immediately shows up in the book of Mark 41 times. So let's take those two and put them together, and let's do a chapter a day out of Joshua. That's be the first 24 days, and then a chapter a day in Mark. That'll be the next 16 days, and after we read that and study that together, then we can all do that, whether we're online or whether we can come to church or not. We can get in God's Word and let God's Word get into us, and then maybe we could have victory on day 41 on Resurrection Day. And so what I've done is I created a place on our website. It's called 41, and you just click on 41, and it already gives you the schedule that's on the back of your sheet tonight. It gives you a look at the scripture that I'm going over tonight, and I've saved the last 40 days to a guy I want to preach on a little bit for the rest of our time together tonight. But I put an introduction on there to tell you why 41 days. It's already there. You can see the link. Just click on it. If you don't know our website, it's thehcc.website. Just type that in, your URL. And you can backslash that and put page 41 and go straight to the 41 page if you know. But click on 41, it's there. And every single day about midnight, 11 o'clock at night, I'll put up the devotion I wrote for that chapter you're on that next day. It'll say day one, Joshua 1. You click on it, and I wrote a page and a half, to be honest, on day one. And every other day, I've written just a page. So it'll take you about 5 minutes to read some insight that God gave me into that chapter. And what I really struggle with is I just got through writing Joshua. I just got through today writing the 24-day devotion for it. And I'm fixing to start on the 16-day devotion for Mark to put them together. Because some people aren't internet people, and so I want to be able to put that in a hard copy for you in a week and a half before it starts on the Sunday before the 23rd, so some of y'all can have it in your hand. So I'm working on it diligently to try to finish it by then. But I get to Joshua chapter 12. In Joshua chapter 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, and 19, eight chapters is on the inheritance that the nation of Israel got. And I got to be honest, I was looking at this at a thing I'm doing now, another job I'm doing tonight, and I'm looking at this, and I'm making my prayer walk, and I'm like, maybe I picked the wrong book. I mean, people are going to stop reading when they get to the cities of the inheritance over and over again. This is a spot in Scripture where a lot of people just stop. And so I'm walking around and I'm praying about, man, what should I do? I've already wrote all the way up to chapter 11, now chapter 12. What do you write on chapter 12? And the Lord impressed on my heart to pass the scripture in 2 Timothy. All scripture is inspired by God. All. And I'm thinking, well, God, you put it in here for a reason. And why would you give us eight chapters of a four-chapter book of the nation of Israel getting to the promised land, why would you use a third of it to talk about inheritance? And I thought, because we have a spiritual inheritance that most of us don't know about. And God whispered into my spirit, read each verse. I promise you there's something in there for you. And so I did, and I'm so glad I did, because I just got through writing on those 8 days, and it's some of the most profound insight God gave me into the Word of anything I wrote on. Because God showed me that a lot of times we miss the miracle because we get stuck in the mundane. And maybe you got to get through the mundane to find the miracle. Maybe we get into the routine and don't realize that God has a word for us for that day. And so over and over again, I was thanking God and praising God when He would show me something in His Word that I got to write on when I would have stopped and I would have fallen short of what God wanted me to hear and know and apply to my life, all because I thought, I'll just skip that. Listen, you'll never get to promised land living if you don't know God's word for your promised land. And He's got a word for you. And maybe you've been wondering, maybe it's been for 40 days, maybe it's been 40 years. I don't know, but God has a promise for you. And He always makes good on His promise. And I can't wait for us to go on this journey together, because I think as excited as people are on Resurrection Day when we celebrate Easter, I think maybe we can see some victories won for Jesus Christ because we studied His Word together, and also thought, hey, in the first 17 weeks of 2021, if our church commits to what we're giving them as a church, we can go through the book of Philippians together, the book of Joshua together, and the book of Mark together. We can find some joy for the journey. We can find promised land living, and we can see how Jesus suffered and became a ransom for us to set us free. And I got to show you this, because my favorite 40 days is in one of my favorite Old Testament texts. It's in 1 Samuel 17. You got to see this. 1 Samuel 17, there's this guy by the name of Goliath. He's a bully. He's been taunting the nation of Israel. He's just begging for someone to come fight him. And I want you to see what God showed me. 1 Samuel 17, verse 16. For 40 days, the Philistine came forward every morning and evening and took his stand. For 40 days. You know when David defeated Goliath? Day 41. You know how old David was when he defeated Goliath? Does anybody have a guess? You had to be 20 to be in the army. He was too young to be in the army. So we know he's under 20, if you study scripture and the history of that day. And he had all those brothers that were older than him. Most scholars put their brothers in order by age and guess. They just guesstimate that David is somewhere in the age of 14 or 15 when he goes against Goliath. So young people, don't ever let somebody say you're too young to live for Jesus. And look, I love this. He's got to go against this giant. And I saw something in the text that really stuck out to me. Look at verse 20 of 1 Samuel 17. You don't have this in your handout, but I got this verse on the screen for you. 1 Samuel 17, verse 20. Early in the morning, David left the flock in the care of a shepherd. He's just a shepherd boy. He's tending sheep on the backside of nowhere. And I can imagine after his brothers got to go off to war and he didn't get to go off to war, and his daddy came in, Jesse, and said, hey, I need you to take the boy something to eat. I bet he was fired up. He's going to get to go see his brothers and get to go be around the fight, be around the battle. He had no idea what he was going to find when he got there. He loaded up and he set out as Jesse had directed. He reached the camp as the army was going out to its battle positions. Don't miss this. Shouting the war cry. Israel, verse 21, and the Philistines were drawing up their lines facing each other. You got to get this picture. This has been going on for 40 days. He gets there on day 40. They tell us that the region where David defeats Goliath is a valley, and there's a hill on both sides. And so the nation of Israel is on one mountaintop, and the Philistine army's on the other mountaintop. And they would draw up their battle lines, and they would shout their war cry. So every single day, morning and evening, twice a day, the nation of Israel would get all their armor on, get suited up like they're ready to fight, walk out in single file line, walk out on top of the hill, look down the valley, and they would have whatever their war cry was, and they would shout it. And then Every morning and every evening they would do it. And every time they did it, Goliath would walk down some part of the way of the hill from the Philistine army, and he would come out and he would defy the army of the nation of Israel. And they would run scared. You would think after day one, morning and evening, day two, they would walk out and shout their war cry. But they did the same thing every single day for 40 days. Please don't miss the theological significance of this in our own lives. We can show up 40 weeks in a row and we can shout our war cry and still not go out and fight the enemy. We can put on the right look, put on the right way we're supposed to dress for church and show up and sing the songs and raise the hands and hear the sermons and still let the giants of our life defeat us and taunt us and still run from them. And a little 15, 14-year-old boy shows up. They had heard it 40 times, morning and evening, 80. He's about to hear it for the first time. And listen what happens. It says, David left his things with the keeper of supplies. I love this. He doesn't just go, oh, what's going on over there? I'll wait over here with the food till my brothers get back. No, he says, somebody here is supposed to keep all this stuff. Here. And he runs to the battle line and asked his brothers how they were. Just imagine this with your whole imagination. His brothers, Goliath has just sounded his little crazy taunt. They're scared, and the brothers are over there talking, and he walks up in the midst, and he really doesn't care how they're doing. He wants to know what's going on. How y'all doing? As they were talking, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance, and David heard it. You know, they had heard it. They were old enough to fight him. They heard it. It's one thing to listen to the enemy. It's another thing to hear what they say about your God. David heard something they hadn't heard before because he's willing to fight. Whenever the Israelites saw the man, they all fled from him in great fear. I love this. The soldiers in the army of Israel, they heard Goliath. They listened to Goliath. And you know how they responded? They ran. David's going to hear Goliath. David's going to listen to Goliath. You know how he's going to respond? With faithful action. He runs later to Goliath to fight him. And I thought about this. I thought, why David for this moment, for this time? I mean, you remember when God sent Samuel to find out who the next anointed was, and they went through all the brothers? And then when they went through all the brothers, they looked at Jesse and said, is this all of them? And Jesse said, oh, there's one, but he's out in the field. As if, I got one more, he's the youngest. You don't need to look at him anyway. And we have that verse in Scripture that says, God, while man looks on the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. David, who everybody forgot, David, who everybody thought was too young, while everybody else looked apart, God saw something. He's going to be a man after his own heart. And listen, this is the same David who's going to fall short miserably after he defeats Goliath. He's going to grow up to commit murder and adultery. And what amazes me is God still calls him a man after my own heart. Not because of his sin, but because of the way he responded to it. And I love this. Look back at what it says about him. Because the world had labeled him. And listen to me, young people. Don't let the world label you. You let God label you. He made you. In 1 Samuel 16, there's a big clue in verse 13. After God anoints David, this is pre-Goliath battle. The Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on. Man, you're going to face some giants. There are going to be some battles that you're going to have to fight. And you can have the right war cry and you can have the right chant. Or you can have the right relationship with the God who set you on a journey to be all he called you to be for him. You know why David did what he did? Because he was anointed to live that life. You know why you can do what you're going to do for these next 40 days and be set free on day 41? Because you're anointed to live this life. That's what you got to tell yourself when you get up and read this every single day. I'm anointed to live this life. God called me to live this life. God wants me to live this life. He doesn't want me in wilderness wanderings. He wants me in promised land living. He didn't die just to forgive me. He died to set me free. And you know what David's going to do? He's going to say, what are they saying? He said, well, here's what the king's going to do for whoever's going to fight the guy. He's going to give his daughter in marriage. He's going to be tax exempt for life. And David's thinking, oh. And you know what? When David asks again after he hears what they're going to give, he asks the second time. You know who gets mad at him for asking? Eliab, the oldest brother. And he puts his little brother down. You know what David says to his brother? He says these words to him. Is there not a cause? He said, I'm just asking a question. And then, is there not a cause? I mean, isn't this giant going against the army of the people of God? Isn't there a battle worth fighting? Listen to me. Every time you do what God calls you to do, there'll be sometimes people, even in your family, they're going to argue about the way you battle a giant. They're not even willing to battle themselves. Listen to God and see what he says. And you know what? After that, it goes to Saul. You know what Saul says? Okay, you want to fight him? Fine. Here, take my armor. David puts it on, and you know the story. It's too big. Won't fit. And basically, he says, I just need stone and a sling. You know, Saul should have been the one to fight him. If you read Scripture, he was the most handsome, and he was a big in stature, and he's the king. But you know what? He tells David had to fight a giant that he wasn't willing to fight either. Don't you love how people tell you how you're supposed to live your life when they're not even living their life for God themselves? Do you know what David did? He didn't listen to his brother. He didn't listen to the king with the small k, because he was anointed to live this life. You know, God gave him some hints along the way. And David mentions them in Scripture in 1 Samuel 17. He said, remember when the lion came out? Remember when the bear came out? You know, I think David was putting it all together, that those were just tests so that he'd be ready to fight this giant. David knew that if he could kill those animals by the power of God, God could do anything through his life. If you read the text, read 1 Samuel 17. David gets his stone and his sling and he runs to the battle line. He runs to the enemy instead of from him. It's time that some of you faced your enemies head on. Because when you read Joshua, I just got through studying it. I just finished it today. When you read Joshua, you know why the people didn't get everything God had told them he was going to promise them? They settled for less than God's best for them. Some of them didn't get all the inheritance they were supposed to get because they didn't destroy the Canaanites when they went into the promised land like God said. They disobeyed God because that would be too hard. So they just settled for less than God's best for them. And I'm going to ask you this question over and over again for these next 40 days. Are you going to settle? Or do you want God's best? Are you going to let God set you free? Are you going to keep on living in the same sin you've been living with and coming to church week after week after week? And whether you come to this church or you're sitting there watching online and studying online, God wants to set you free. Why would you not let God set you free from the trials and tribulations? Why would you want to stay in 40 days when 41's coming? There's a text in Scripture. I got a message I'm working on. I actually borrowed it from an idea I heard from Samuel Gilbert. He preaches a message that's simply entitled, One More Night with the Frogs. And when he preached it at our church, I thought, when he gave the title, I said, that's a cool title. What's he going to talk about? And then he showed us in Scripture when all the plagues are happening and Moses is trying to get Pharaoh to let the people go. Frogs get everywhere in one of the plagues, and Pharaoh comes out and he has this conversation with Moses, and he says, I'll let them go, but tomorrow. You know, basically what he was telling, just give me one more night with the frogs. He could have said right then, and God would have set him free, but he decided for one more night with the frogs. Frogs in your bed, frogs in your pillow, frogs on your plate, frogs everywhere. I'm working the other night, and I'm walking through this place for a security guard, and there's just a narrow little sidewalk, and it's been raining, and finally it stopped raining. I put my umbrella down, and there's one dark place in the back side of the property, this little sidewalk by the conference center, and I'm walking down the sidewalk, and out of nowhere, this frog jumps out and scared the wibby-jibbies out of me. I almost stepped right on him. I got home and a man said, "Did you have a good night?" I said, "Yeah, except for this frog that scared the living daylights out of me." What a tough guy, right? Frog. I hate frogs, right? But what Pharaoh was saying is he knew that God had the power to take the frogs away immediately, but he decided to give him, "Just give me one more night with the frogs. You can deliver me from them tomorrow." Why? Why in this green earth would you say tomorrow when God could do it today? And I tell you that story to tell you this. You may not need 41 days. I'm definitely not suggesting to you that God has to wait to day 41 to set you free. He may set you free on day 6. He may set you free on day 12. Praise him if he does. But there's something special in Scripture about these 40 days or 40 years of trials and testings, but then 41 comes. And I love the fact that Goliath went down on day 41. And all these people that have been shouting a war cry, all these people that had got their battle array on and their chant just right, and Goliath had come out and they had run away scared for 40 days and 40 nights, David shows up and God shows out. And now all those people have courage to go fight the Philistine army that still had giants. Maybe you being set free can encourage somebody else to be set free. Maybe God could do something in our midst. Maybe we could grow through these 40 days and we could celebrate on Easter Sunday victory after victory after victory of people getting to their promised land that God has provided for you, but you're not living in it yet. And we're going to take these Wednesday nights, me and Brother Cliff talked about it, and we're going to try to gear whatever day we're on to the preaching time in here on Wednesday nights to help us put all this together as a church family. And so I'm just asking you tonight, what is your giant? What are you battling? And I'm going to ask you to lay it at the altar tonight during our time of prayer. And if you say this tonight to him, "Lord, if you're willing, set me free," hear him say, "I'm willing. Be clean. Be set free." I got family members that need to be set free of some things. I got some friends that need to be set free of some things. I got some things in my heart, my life, that God needs to set me free of. And I believe with all my heart, the same God who was willing is the same God who still is. And he can. And I believe he will. And let's go on the journey together. God, I thank you so much for just the opportunity to study your word together with a family of faith, whether we're online or whether we're right here in person. Thank you for your word and the fact that it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It can cut both ways. It could show us things that need to be cut out of our lives, and it can show us some things, it can point out some things that need to be there. And I thank you that all of your word is useful for teaching us and correcting us and inspiring us and instructing us to be thoroughly equipped for every good work you have for us. You speak to us through your word. And I'm praying, God, that through these 40 days together, that day 41 will be days of victory. Days of deliverance, days of you taking down our giants. God, I pray that as we start this journey in a couple weeks, that you would prepare our hearts for what you want to do. God, we don't want to be like your people in the book of Joshua that took 40 years to get beneath your promises because they doubted and they got distracted and they disobeyed. So help us to be obedient to your word. Help us to be strong and courageous to do all that you've called us to do. We don't want to settle for less than your best for us. And God, you can do whatever you want to do no matter what's going on in our world today because you're the creator of it. And I pray, God, that you would not just forgive people but help them to find freedom. I pray you'd set them free. God, tonight as we pray over a prayer list, there are a lot of people on that list that need you to show up and intervene in their situation. And I thank you so much, God, that you're still a God who redeems and heals and you restore families and you save marriages. You bring people out of addictions. You touch lepers. They be clean. You're the same God who can touch our lives today. Give us a fresh start. And I pray, God, that you would touch our hearts during this prayer time for other people and for the giants that we're facing in our own lives. Help us not to run from them any longer, but let you defeat them as we put our faith and trust in you. God, thank you. Thank you that even though we go through trials and testings, thank you that deliverance is coming. God, would you help us like we just read in Scripture where it said David heard. God, help us to hear you, our God, more than we hear what the giants in our world are saying to us. Speak to our hearts, God, and help us to hear your voice and your voice only. Not the voice of other people's opinions or other people's suggestions, but what you say we are and how you created us to be. And I pray over all of this tonight, we will hear you tell your children that we're anointed to live this life. In Jesus' name.
I'm going to ask them to bring our prayer lists down and lay them at the altar. You can pick one up at your convenience before you leave. You can come. But, you know, I like a plan, and this is an awesome plan. And some of the things that I think maybe you could do is not only spending this journey with brothers and sisters in the Lord, but maybe for 40 days, you could pray for a different person every day, a different family, and let that family know that you've designated this day. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to pray for your family. You can also reach out to somebody every one of those 40 days. And this is what I envision. And you just get ready for this. If I invite 40 people to church here on Easter and they see the celebration of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and 40, all 40 of them come, and you invite 40, every day, I'm going to invite somebody. Lord, lay somebody on my heart. I'm going to reach out to them. Can I ask you a question? Where are we going to put all those people? Don't worry about it. Because God may be preparing for multitudes to be set free. Let's bow together. Go before the Lord at this time. You're welcome to come to the altar. You're welcome to pray right where you are. Let's spend a few moments in the presence of the Lord and let Him lead us in this time. Thank you. Father, we thank you for the leadership in this church that's you. Jesus is the head of this body. Lord, give us discernment from your Holy Spirit as you guide us in this journey. And it's exciting to know that we're all going to take a journey together. That means we'll be reading the Word together on the same theme, the same issues, the same page. And then, God, you're free to speak to us. And you're free, Lord, to begin that transformation of what's going to happen as deliverance comes in our life. Freedom comes. And, Lord, I'm excited. I look forward to the spiritual journey. And I thank you, Lord, for the preparing this and laying this out before the body. And I'm about to get excited about it, God. We need not a stimulus package from the United States government. We need to be stimulated from the power of a holy God. We need you, Lord. And people need Jesus as Lord and Savior. And for people that leave this earth without you, Lord, what have we missed? Lord, help us to take every opportunity we can to love people and to share our love with people and to proclaim that there is salvation in no other than the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Lead us in this journey, and may the blessings abound, and may freedom come. And God, may you draw us together as one, united as one, for the glory of the kingdom of God. Blessed be your name, and all praise and glory be unto you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight, and thank you for being a part. And remember, who knows what day this starts? Anybody got that? 23rd. Who knows when it's in? This is an easy one. Easter Sunday, April the 4th. God bless you guys, and have a great week this week.